My name is Margie Grant, and I am the Chief Executive Officer of Florida Realtors. Florida Realtors is the largest trade association in the state of Florida, and I represent over 200,000 proud professionals who represent and lead the real estate industry. Ladies and gentlemen, the real estate market has led us out of 5 of the last 6 recessions, and it's doing the same today. Florida is leading the nation in real estate sales and economic viability, and we are so incredibly lucky to live in a state as great as this one. We are so excited to partner with all of our international partners and friends, and we want to make sure that as we come through this pandemic, we all remember that the word home and the word office and the word business have taken on a whole new meaning, and the international marketplace has seen the same. In the state of Florida, we are so incredibly fortunate for the incredible increasing investment by international partners in Florida real estate. We have 2 top markets that we are so incredibly proud of. The largest one is Canada, that invested over $3.2 billion in 2020 alone, and it was followed by one of our Latin American friends, Brazil. One of the things that has enlightened us through the pandemic is the importance of the future and understanding the increasing changes in our environment. And that has led to an increased focus and a new appreciation for the importance of sustainability. Business leaders and world leaders now realize that we have to do everything we can to protect the generations to come. It is my honor to first and foremost thank the World Strategic Forum as well as the International Economic Forum of the Americas for bringing you this afternoon's final session. Please join me in welcoming Mr. Gustavo Montezano, President of Brazil National Bank for Economic and Social Development in Sao Paulo, who will discuss how can business lead sustainable change. Also, please join me in welcoming Jessica Bryce, Senior Editor for Latin America for Bloomberg News. Thank you so much. Welcome.
So much for sitting down and talking with us. Why don't we kick off by having you tell us a little bit about your experience and what you set out to do when you took the helm of BNDES, which is a very important bank in the Brazilian economy.
So, Jessica, thanks for the interview. Pleasure to be here speaking with yourself. And I like to say that my experience in BNDES is trying to get out of a bank and getting back to a bank, because I spent my whole life working in investment banking. And in 2016, I moved from São Paulo to London, and then stayed there from 16 to 18, and then decided to go back to Brazil to help my country. And at first glance, it was out of BNDES, in the Minister of Economy, but 6 months later, I was invited to join the BNDES. And I'm quite happy to be here again with the investment bank. That's something that I love, especially when you are working for your country.
That's great. And it's been about 2 years, 3 years now that you've been running the bank.
Yeah. 2 years and 3 months
now. Yeah. The market is nervous and has been for some time about political and economic reforms in Brazil, mm-hmm. right? In your opinion, are they progressing at a good pace? And what are these measures expected to do to encourage employment and income growth?
Yeah, first, we would like to say that, of course, we want more. And of course, we need to do more. But looking backwards, we had in 19, the social security reform was something that was being waited for a decade and quite material. So 19 was a decent year. In reforms, yes, the social security is a big reform by itself. When you go to 2020, we have the whole pandemic fight against it, and we have the sanitation reform. We also had the, you can't even remember all of them, but some relevant ones as well. So when you see the sanitation reform plus all measures that were discussed and approved in the Congress, like support to states, support to families, support to corporates, new credit lines. When you see everything that was done during the crisis in 2020, I just think that was a productive year as well. And now that we are in 2021, I can tell you that we have an independent central bank. We have the law of economic freedom. We have the rail renovation. We have the new gas framework, the new electricity framework. So it's a whole revolution going on sector specific. Again, we want more. Yes. Do we need more? Yes. Would like that to be faster? Yes. But looking backwards, if you see all the what happened the last 2 years, I think we're doing quite a good job.
Right, right. And these reforms are certainly expected to help boost economic growth. Transitioning, there's a growing discussion about the sustainability of the recovery that we're experiencing now, past 2021. What are your views on that?
Nowadays, especially after the COVID, if you're speaking about a corporate strategy or a country strategy at micro level or macroeconomic level, you must take in consideration sustainability. You must take in consideration innovation and sustainability, both on the environmental side and also the social side. It's clear that, especially for emerging markets, if you do not take in consideration the social side of your plans, again, both corporates or countries, you'll be missing something. So when you speak about doing a project, preparing a strategy, hiring people, naturally, financial sustainability is relevant because you need to pay your bills, but it must take in consideration all aspects of the call ESG, which the three letters that we are using to summarize a big philosophical shift that you see in the corporate world.
Right, and ESG investing is certainly garnering a lot of excitement. What do you think are the opportunities in Brazil, and how has BNDES adjusted its own portfolio in that respect?
Yeah, I like to compare the ESG moment we live nowadays as something similar with proportions to what happened in the US economy in the 70s or 80s when the private equity industry just was starting to boom. And that moment, you had a lot of new financial techniques and financial products that slowly they started being adopted by some corporates. And at the beginning, the market was split between the private equity, the financial managed companies, and the traditional companies. And what happened later on, we know. Either you adopt it, or you get out of the table, or you were acquired. When you see this ESG movement happening nowadays, I see something similar, because it's a big shift on the cultural side of the society in the dynamics of the market. And still today, we're trying to narrow or ring fence the ESG market. But in my view, it's a new shift, and it will soon become mainstream, right? And going to Brazil itself, I think it's on the environmental side is a big opportunity, right? When you look at Brazil as a country, we have the largest natural capital in the world, right? We have a very dynamic and creative financial markets. And if you compare Brazil with other emerging market economies, again, forget an instance developed economies, but let's compare with emerging market. The rule of law works here. So in all this green revolution, we have creativity, we have financial power, we have a big democracy, and we have the natural capital. So we have all the ingredients to lead the green agenda. Our biggest challenge is in the social side, because the pandemia left rich people richer because we saved money, but poor people poorer. So the social inequality of Brazil and emerging economies across the globe just increased. So looking at ESG, big opportunity for Brazil in the environmental or green side, huge challenge on the social side. That's how we position BNDES to play our attributes or our strengths and to protect on the social side.
Right. And speaking on the social side, the Development Bank has an important role in supporting small and mid-sized companies. Did COVID-19 change that at all?
Absolutely. during 2020, we accessed or we reached most SMEs that we have ever did in any year of the bank. And why did it happen? Because we needed to fight against the war or the crisis, and we innovate. So it's a very interesting story, because at the beginning of the pandemic, we did a benchmark with other development banks across the globe, trying to find out what were they doing that we could improve ourselves. And after the benchmark between 15 or 20 institutions, was clear. We are doing likely 80% of the global average was doing, but we're missing the credit insurance. It was a big question at the beginning, but why are we not doing credit insurance? Two reasons. First, because it never developed in Brazil, mm-hmm. as simple as that. And second, because of the large concentration of public banks in Brazil, federal banks. So we decided that we should bring with a credit insurance product in the crisis. It was a big job, a collective job, doing between public and private banks, Congress, federal government. We all worked together. And we, at the end of the day, we're able to increase the whole credit markets of SME in Brazil from roughly 550 billion reais on February 2020 to almost 800 or 750 billion reais nowadays.
Oh, wow.
So, and most of them because of the credit insurance.
More than a 50% increase there.
Yes.
Wow.
Yes.
Let's move over to infrastructure. Brazilian infrastructure needs are very high. What do you see as the best way to develop that sector?
Good projects, good modeling. We spent two decades in Brazil, or 15 years, let's say, where our infrastructure was based on deep subsidies.
Right.
So it's like I'm giving money for someone to build something. When you are just subsidizing, you restrain innovation, you restrain risk-taking. You make a crowd out of new minds playing the game. So one of the big consequences of this, I would say, very badly executed strategy, was that Brazil has a closed infrastructure market, few players, high entry barriers, and poor project preparation, because project preparation is a key barrier to enter in this market. And nowadays, we are hugely investing in this department or division within BNDES to prepare and model products. And if you take a look, Jessica, on all products that we bring to market in the last 3, 4, 5 years, they all have succeeded. So if you have a project with good good contract, good engineering model, good environmental components, a well-structured with proper market selling, there will be demand for that. In the long, long run, if you think 10 years ahead, we may have an issue of long-term BRL funding. But in the short term, like 3 or 5 years, our main bottleneck is good project preparation, and you need to build this pipeline as a long-term strategy of BNDES, and that's what we're doing.
In privatizations, concessions, BNDES asset sales are very much in that vein. How is the BNDES pipeline in that regard?
Yeah, first I'd like to explain why BNDES is divesting. When I joined the bank in 2019, we had roughly 90 billion reais of book equity value in our balance sheet, and roughly 120 billion speculative equity portfolio. So think about a development bank, which more than 100% of our equity book value is invested in speculative equity, like Petrobras, Vale do Rio Doce, JBS. Makes no sense. Our equity should be invested in producing new investments, on leveraging SMEs, not speculating in the secondary market. And that's why we've been divesting since the last 2 years, and in a very, I would say, a prudent mode. We're not selling, but the market is buying our positions, right? We're quite happy with the involvement so far, but we still have 70 billion reais to be sold, and we're not in a rush. We're not in a rush. We're just executing the same mode we've been doing for the last 2 years, prudently, smoothly, and waiting the better moments, right? Going to privatizations, we can discuss many topics, because we have, as of today, many ministers as our clients, and roughly, I'd say, 10 or 50% of the Brazilian states are governance as our clients, and Agenda's moving quite well.
Eletrobras is obviously one of the big ones, right? And one of the big privatizations. What's the relevance of that project to Brazil, to to markets who are watching Brazil?
It's critical again because first it's a signal that we are moving to our agenda of reducing the size of the stake where there's a need, so we can focus on the social side where it's needed. In the second hand, we'll be creating. I think it's the 15th largest power company in the world, and likely the largest power company in Latin America. And it's a big corporation, Brazilian based. So both are signaling the movement of Brazilian state and improving the landfill player and the relevant agent in the Brazilian financial markets is critical for our power sector. We're quite excited. I cannot tell you so much about details of the privatization because it's a listed equity, so we have a lot of restrictions to comment, but we keep our agenda of bringing that to the market next year.
Of course, and Correios, which is the postal service, is another big one. It's probably the second big one there. What moving from a public company to a private company, certainly for something like a postal service, which has typically mm-hmm. been a public service, what's the growth potential there? And do you think that both Eletrobras and the Correios one will be concluded soon?
Yeah, when you look at both Correios and Eletrobras, one of the main reasons to bring that to the market is to unleash their investment potential, because both Eletrobras has the largest market share in power generation in Brazil, and Correios the largest market shares in e-commerce delivery in Brazil. But they don't have availability of investments funds. So we do need investment in Brazil. Privatizing Correios, and I like to say, it will represent a revolution in the Brazilian low-scale logistics, right? Brazil is a large country. It's like a Western Europe in size. And having an e-commerce with powerful logistics is critical for our SME entrepreneurs in Brazil. Because if it depends only on a state-owned company to deliver, you can imagine about the service, right? So if you're producing something in the countryside of the Amazon forest or in the countryside of Northeast, and it's expensive to ship, and you're delayed, how can you be competing with people that live in the big cities, right? And we need to reduce this barrier and improve the quality of services for those SMEs across Brazil so they can be more competitive. And I like to connect the Correios privatization with the Port of Santos Harbor. And when you combine both concessions or privatizations together, both on large scale items and small things, you'll be a complete revolution of logistics in Brazil, reducing the size of transportation, of anything that you can imagine within our country.
Right. And Brazil definitely needs that revolution in terms of logistics. Absolutely.
More than you like to, but yes, we need to be much, much more competitive.
Right. Well, thank you so much for taking the time to speak with us. I think it's been a very interesting conversation.
Thank you. My pleasure. I hope it was useful.